Ursula K. Le Guin is the child of two prominent anthropologists and intellectual heir of Lord Dunsany, a pioneering fantasy writer. Her Earthsea novels are honored children's literature. Her adult science fiction Hainish novels, two of which won both the Hugo and the Nebula Awards, show, as did Heinlein, the potential power of a series setting. Works like The Dispossessed and The Word for World is Forest offer ambiguous utopias. The Left Hand of Darkness breaks down the supposedly natural differences of gender, frees science fiction from a fundamentally American conception of Earthman, and even confronts Western civilization, and even confronts Western Cartesian thought with an alien philosophy, drawn, as it happens, from Taoism. In form, The Left Hand of Darkness, like Robbe-Grillet's The Erasers, is an advance on Zola's notion of experimental fiction, and in its treatment of language, makes a feminist Stapledonian challenge to the reader. Ursula K. Le Guin is one of the great writers of science fiction and fantasy. Her work in many genres has been influential and widely honored. The Left Hand of Darkness was the second novel ever to win both a Hugo from the fans and a Nebula Award from the writers as the best novel of the year. The first novel to be so honored was Dune by Frank Herbert, published just 4 years earlier, and the third was in fact Le Guin's own The Dispossessed, published in 1974. Her Earthsea cycle, beginning with A Wizard of Earthsea, earned a Newbery Silver Medal and a National Book Award. In this series, the protagonists must learn the truths about the shadows they cast and the power of calling things by their true names. But while her children's work is superb, it is in her adult science fiction that she blazes trails. Science fiction, from Shelley's monster to Heinlein's conscious computer or Clark's conscious computer, has always asked what it means to be human. Le Guin became a key figure in the feminism of the 1960s and 70s by asking also what it means to be gendered. Le Guin's work reveals three powerful influences from her childhood. Le Guin's father, Alfred L. Kroeber, was one of the founding giants of modern anthropology. He published an essay called The Oikumene, in which he argued that the diversity of Indo-European culture had all spread from a single source. Kroeber's work is, in a sense, a descendant of that of the Grimm brothers. Just as the Grimm brothers were able to show us that the sounds of modern English, p, t, k, in Latin becoming f, th, h, in modern English, have a descent which parallels that of the p, t, k, in modern Romance languages, Kroeber was able to organize all of what was known at that time about diffusion, the process of cultural movement, not only of language sounds, but also of techniques such as fire building and objects such as the screw, in order to make an argument that all of the diversity of human culture, or at least of Indo-European culture, could be traced back to one original group, which he named the Oikumene. This word clearly comes from oikonomia, economics, which itself comes from the Greek oikos, meaning house. Economics is household management. The Oikumene is the group that lived in that primordial home. This notion of cultural diffusion, of the ways in which things spread but are nonetheless remain the same, is key to Le Guin's thinking in so much of her work. Le Guin's mother, Theodora Kroeber, was most famous for her book Ishi in Two Worlds, a biography of the last wild Indian in North America. The question that Theodora Kroeber truly poses in this study of one lone person is this: can one sustain an identity without a supporting culture within which that identity can be defined? The third influence is Lord Dunsany. At the age of 12, according to Le Guin, she fell under his spell. Dunsany, in short stories like those collected in The Sword of Welleran, is usually credited with having invented the self-contained fantasy otherworld, a device since used by Tolkien and many others. After World War I, Dunsany published some much darker novels, like The Charwoman's Shadow. Guin notices already the connection between Dunsany's use of shadow and shadow in the Earthsea trilogy. In Dunsany's work, the hero retrieves a crone's shadow for her from a magician, only to find then that he has found a bride. Many of Le Guin's science fictions are noteworthy. The Lathe of Heaven, for example, explores the power of dreams and the pitfalls of unintended consequences. In this novel, our two main characters are a psychiatrist and his patient. The psychiatrist has the insight that the patient is accomplishing something with his dreams that the patient does not realize. It seems that when the patient dreams, the world conforms to his dreams. And when he awakens into a world in which everyone simply takes that world to be the normal world. For example, the patient falls asleep in Portland, wakes up the next day, and there's no Mount Hood. But he awakens into a world in which there has never been a Mount Hood, and none of the people in the world he walks around in think there has ever been a Mount Hood. But somehow the psychiatrist comes to understand that these dreams are in fact changing the world, that everyone is unwittingly being moved from one version of reality to another by his patient. And so the psychiatrist, with the best intentions in the world, tries to influence the thinking of his patient so that he will dream a better world. And what happens, of course, is that with every intervention on the part of the psychiatrist, unintended consequences make the world, in fact, worse. The word for world is forest is set on a jungle planet. This, too, is a Hugo Award-winning novel. It is an exploration of language, and it turns out to be also an anti-Vietnam War book. The word for world is forest, the title, is meant to remind us that our word for our world is earth, that is, dirt, that perhaps brown stuff we put our hands in and plant plants in and live from. Mother Earth is one of our words for world. Although Le Guin does not mention it, our language carries with it a recognition that the word world really does not mean primarily the globe. The word world comes from Old English wer ald. The wer means man, as in werewolf. The ald means era or time, as in Aldang Syne. The wer ald is the age of man. And we still use the word world that way. In the world of television, they do things this way. In the world of publishing, they do things that way. Had I but world enough and time, if I had the things that matter to people and the time to use them. In other words, the world is a social construction. Our word for world is earth. But on this jungle planet, the word for world is forest. The United States spent a great deal of effort during the Vietnam War defoliating the lush jungle which gave cover to their enemies traveling around. In this novel, the humans who come to the planet try to defoliate parts of it in order to set up their own camps and begin to colonize it. What they discover is that all of the trees are rhizomatically connected beneath the ground with each other. The entire planet is one living vegetable life. The word for world is forest. Now, while the importance of this novel as an anti-Vietnam War book may be only historical for us at this moment, the exploration of language, I think, has continuing value. To understand that the way we name things produces social realities, that accepting someone else's naming of things imposes a social reality, is a crucial, crucial lesson that imaginative literature has dealt with time and again. When Alice walks out of the garden of the forest of no language, and suddenly the fawn around whose neck she has her arm realizes that she's a little girl and you're a fawn, and they part, that imposition of language creates a social reality. When Robbe-Grillet decides that he's going to use a flat cinematic language to get rid of the imposition, the anthropomorphization of nature, and thus lay claim to freedom, he's doing something imaginatively to get us past what language does. That's what Le Guin is after in The Word for World is Forest, in another way, by making us realize that our word for world isn't forest, it's earth, and by that contrast, making us see more clearly. The Dispossessed is another novel of Le Guin's that contains very important contrasts. Here we have a planet and its major satellite, which together have two different kinds of utopian communities. That's utopia with a U. Neither turns out to be an a-utopia. The Dispossessed explores these social issues with great subtlety, and as I said, it has won both the Hugo and the Nebula Awards. The Left Hand of Darkness, like The Dispossessed and The Word for World is Forest, are all among what Le Guin calls her Hainish novels. The Hain are a group that originally seeded life in the universe. We humans are later developments, outposts in the spreading Hainish world. We can see the influence of A.L. Kroeber's notion of the Oikoumene in the notion of the Hainish novels. There are some connections among the Hainish novels, although each of them is freestanding. For example, the husband of the protagonist in The Dispossessed invents something called the Ansible, which makes possible communication instantaneously across light years. That Ansible turns out to be crucial in The Left Hand of Darkness. In both Zola's and Robbe-Grillet's senses of the term, The Left Hand of Darkness is an experimental novel. In Zola's sense of the term, it's an experimental novel because it sets up a set of social relations, and then we see what happens as those social relations try to work their way out. In Robbe-Grillet's sense of the term, the book tries to make us adopt a language not normally our own, to see if speaking that language, allowing it to control us, will give us a new perspective that will free us, in this case, among other things, from the imposition of gender categories. In this novel, we find our characters on a frozen world known in English as winter, in its own language as Gethin. On Gethin, we find an earth-like monarchy and a bureaucracy. The unique Gethinian sexuality overtly questions our gender stereotypes. Those who have not read the novel need to understand this Gethinian sexuality. All Gethinians are of one sex. However, there comes a period, a cyclic period, the way women in Homo sapiens have periodicity when they are fertile and menstruating. There comes a period when the normally placid Gethinians become sexually heightened. If they are in the presence of someone who is already in a sexually heightened male state, their body will invert and they will form female parts and they will become very sexually active as females. If they are in the presence of a female, their body will evert and they will form male parts and become a very sexually active male. If no one is in their presence, then they will, apparently on a random basis, become either male or female. For the Gathenians, most of life is sexually placid. But when they are in chemer, when they are at that moment, when they are in a sexually active cycle, the sexual passions are so strong that society has created special chemer houses where they can go to meet each other and pursue their almost irresistible urges. The key point about this ambisexuality from a social viewpoint is that any Gathenian might become a mother, and any Gathenian might become a father. And in fact, many Gathenians become both. And so the special role of being male or female, of one being a sex object for one reason or another for another reason, all of those things are eliminated. The very fundamental imagination of ambisexuality on Le Guin's part questions our gender stereotypes. The action on Gethin concerns an envoy from the Ecumen, a group association throughout the Hainish worlds, which simply wants to enlist Gethin as another member of the Hainish worlds. Simply get them to join for the possibilities of cultural cross-fertilization, to allow more diffusion. The Ecumen sounds a lot like the Ecumene. Genli'ai is this envoy from the Ecumen, and by the way, he happens to be Homo sapiens, and he happens to be male, and although not much is made of it, he happens to be black. He is unique on Gethin in that he alone, without the taking of drugs, stays one sex and always that one sex. He's treated as an oddity. But there's one man, there is one Gathenian, Therum Harth Rem Er Estravin, who truly sees that this strange creature, whom some call pervert, could be a bridge to a greater world. The world of Gethin is, in fact, rather provincial. And Therum Harth Rem Er Estravin understands that. He's in a position, he thinks, perhaps to do something about it, because he is the prime minister to the king of his own land. The world there is divided into a monarchy and a bureaucracy. We have a microcosm, or reflection of Earth's world. We see a developing relationship between Therum, or Estravin, he's called both, and Genli'ai. The story is told in chapters that use one of four different voices. Some of the chapters are told in Genli's voice. Some of the chapters are told in Estravin's voice. Some of the chapters are field notes from the investigators from the Ecumen who came down incognito before Genli'ai was sent. And some of the chapters are told as if they were anthropological notes. They simply report important legends and myths of Gethin. When we come to understand at the end that all of this book is put together by Genli after the death of Therum, we realize that Genli is trying to allow us to hear these different voices. Le Guin's experiment in voice is meant to pursue the truth of her assertion at the beginning of the novel that truth is a matter of the imagination. The imagination is aided in this novel by neologism, by making up new words that help us remember what should be something different. Kemmer is that time of sexual activity. Somer is the time when one is normal and untroubled by sexual urges. A key term on Gethin is Schiffgrathor. Schiffgrathor is translated as something like the Japanese notion of face, that is, how you look to the world and whether or not you can be proud because of it. Why not then just use the word face? Because we're told that Schiffgrathor comes from an ancient word meaning shadow. The relation between Le Guin's world and ours arises in part from what I call transformed language, not just neologisms, but transformations of language that we already know. For example, we learn that they have a phrase on this frozen planet, the glaciers didn't freeze overnight. This is clearly a transformation of our phrase, Rome wasn't built in a day. But think of what the differences are. Rome, in Rome wasn't built in a day, stands for something huge, massive, controlling of all of human activity. It is the empire. On Gethin, that role is taken over by the glaciers. Human beings do not shape the world. The world shapes human beings. Rome wasn't built in a day. The glaciers didn't freeze overnight. Language also helps us decenter our normal view by having the different characters speak in different ways. However, the pronoun he is still used for Gethinians. At the time she wrote the book, feminists applauded Le Guin for creating this ambisexual people that would question what sexuality means. But later, as feminism itself evolved in America, people began to wonder if she should not have used she or made up an entirely new pronoun for her Gethinians. Le Guin drew Gethinian philosophy as a fundamental alternative to Western Cartesian thought. As it happens, she could have used words we know about, the way she could have used face instead of Schiffgrathor, but she makes up other things in order to give her story a sense of freshness, so that we can't simply dismiss this story as, oh, well, that's like Japan, or in the case of the philosophy, that's like China. The story of the Left Hand of Darkness is one in which the two characters, Genli Ai and Therim Harth Remir Estravin, need to come to understand each other, and they come from very opposing positions culturally. They are perhaps as different as mirror images, which we know from our analysis of Alice in Wonderland, or I should say more accurately, Through the Looking Glass, are not really oppositions or reversals, but apparent oppositions and reversals. The central religious text in the Left Hand of Darkness is called Tormer's Lay, a lay being a song, Tormer being the person who first came up with this. Light is the left hand of darkness, and darkness the right hand of light. Two are one, life and death, lying together like lovers in Kemmer, like hands joined together, like the end and the way. The Tao Te Ching, the founding text of Chinese philosophy, religion, our Western terms don't map to this too well, is told in a series of poems, each of which is numbered. Here is number 11 of the Tao. It seems to me that it is emblematic of the way in which the Tao makes us think both of things and their opposites as being crucial for the world. 30 spokes are made one by holes in a hub, by vacancies joining them for a wheel's use. The use of clay in molding pitchers comes from the hollow of its absence. Doors, windows in a house are used for their emptiness. Thus we are helped by what is not to use what is. Light is the left hand of darkness, the end and the way. The Tao Te Ching is sometimes translated as the way or the way of life. And later, long after the composition of the left hand of darkness, Le Guin herself issued a translation of the Tao. Theram, in fact, is unsuccessful in helping Genli open up Gethen to the Ecumen while he is prime minister, but that he would even try causes him to be thrown into prison, and it is only when he is the opposite of himself, when he is, in fact, a criminal outlaw, that he is able to succeed. Genli goes and meets him in that prison, and together they escape and have a moment on the Gobrin ice. They are on those glaciers that did not freeze overnight. They are alone together in a hut. Alone together without the support of their cultures behind them, each must confront the other completely. Just as we see in the Martian chapter of the Martian Chronicles, Night Meeting chapter of the Martian Chronicles, two characters alone without their societies come to understand each other. There is only one episode in all of this novel that is narrated from more than one viewpoint, although there are four viewpoints used to tell the story. That one episode I call the Mind Speak episode. It is the episode on the Gobrin ice where Theram and Genli suddenly learn to communicate telepathically. It turns out that humans can do that. They are educed at about puberty and learn to mind speak, but Gethenians do not. However, at a moment when Theram is in Kemmer and is so much aware of the masculine presence of Genli, there is a breakthrough, and Theram believes he hears a voice, the voice of his dead sibling with whom he has had a child. Incest taboos do not exist on Gethen. And that voice turns out to be Genli's. By their closeness, having given up their outer societies, suddenly what he understands, what Theram understands, is the deepest love he's had in his life. That is the voice of his brother, but it's the thoughts of Genli. When they leave the ice, through machinations quite interesting to follow in terms of the plot, Theram arranges to draw the pursuers, they have escaped prison, away so that Genli can make a run that will allow him to bring back news that will change the political climate of Gethen to make possible the entry of the Gethen into the Ecumen. In the course of doing this, Theram is killed. But the outreach succeeds. The opening chapter of the novel concerns the building of a bridge, and it's a ceremonial occasion, and the bridge is built with mortar that's colored red because they believe on Gethen that all bridges must have blood within them to support the bridging. Theram's blood supports the bridging to the outer world. The book ends with two different ways of being understood. One is an overt political ending, where we have heroism and sacrifice and an errand of honor conveyed by the envoy, that performed by the envoy to go back to Theram's people and explain about his death after he has opened up Gethen to the Ecumen. At that point, he talks to Theram's son, and the son says, "I should like to hear that tale, my lord envoy, about the heroic past." But then he says, "Will you tell us how he died? Will you tell us about the other worlds, out among the stars, the other kinds of men, the other lives?" Youth wants to know more. The other ending is to recognize that this is a covert love story. Only Theram understood Gethen, understood Genli. And through the course of time, Genli finally learned to trust the love of Therem. Not a consummated physical love, but an emotional love, a maturing love. And so when Therem dies for Genli's errand, Genli feels guilt. And he constructs the book in such a way that we can see his own failures of understanding at the beginning, and his language modifies as he goes through, so that he begins to speak finally more like Therem. Here is verse 10 of the Tao. Remember the Gobran ice in the hut. Can you hold the door of your tent wide to the firmament? Can you, with the simple stature of a child breathing nature, become notwithstanding a man? Can you continue befriending with no prejudice, no ban? Can you, mating with heaven, serve as the female part? Can your learned head take leaven from the wisdom of your heart? If you can bear issue and nourish its growing, if you can guide without claim or strife, if you can stay in the lead of men without their knowing, you are at the core of life. Genli is finally changed, and he sees the humans who land as perverts. Like Gulliver, who cannot talk to humans after living with the Winims, or Prendick, who stays alone after being with the Beast People, he is transformed. Le Guin gives us a Stapledonian viewpoint that transcends mere humans. It transcends language, it transcends genders, it transcends personal morality, and it asks us to free ourselves to see what really matters in the world and what we're willing to give for the greatest love.